Hi, and welcome to your weekly macro roundup, where we talk macro, trying to make sense of markets that really don't make any sense. I'm your host, Steve Van Meter, and thanks for joining me today. I got a great episode lined up for you. Now, coming out of the rumor mill, as early next week, I will be going for a walk around the world with Martin North. So for all of you who are big fans of Martin North Show, and I am, look for that early next week. Now, there's a lot of great feedback from the inflation episode on Wednesday, mainly about how several of you point out, Steve, there's quite a few inaccuracies in that. In fact, one person said, I found two things that he was wrong about. I'm like, hey, that's pretty good. When you don't really do a lot of show prep and don't have time to do a lot of that, I use a lot of examples that sometimes I later on look back, and then of course many of you help me look back and say, yeah, that probably was a pretty poor choice. But what was really great is it spurred some conversations in the comments about what I was wrong about, and other people chimed in, and there's some learning going on, which I thought was great. And several of you came to my defense and said, but that wasn't really what he was focused on. And Steve was talking about, you know, currency printing inflation. And I'm glad that most of you understood that from a big picture, there's a lot of things that can go into an increase in prices. And I just don't care for the term inflation for the reason anything goes up in price. Well, I look at inflation is from a currency printing standpoint, and since we know the Fed can't print money, and we know when the federal government borrows money, it's not printing money, that only money is created when banks lend. And that's why on Fridays, it's one of my favorite macro days, because that's when the H.8 data comes out. And that's why we go through it to find out, is there any lending going on? Because you know, people have all these reasons for, you know, why interest rates are either up or down or whatever way they're going. And the simple answer is, it's not just QE that's causing interest rates to stay low-ish. You know, people are like, well, if the Fed wasn't doing QE, interest rates would go up. That's not necessarily true at all. Because if you don't have lending growth, it doesn't matter. You can't have higher interest rates when there's no demand for lending. I mean that, or if there is demand for lending, as some of you pointed out, there's people that do want to borrow, yes, but the banks aren't lending them. Well, it's the same difference. If there isn't lending growth, you're not going to have higher interest rates. If you do have higher interest rates, they will be transitory and ultimately lead to lower interest rates. Why is that? Well, it's simple. Most people tend to want to borrow when interest rates are what, going up or down? Well, logically, you'd think if they're going up, people would want to borrow. But reality is people do most of their borrowing when interest rates are low. You don't really hear people say, man, I got three quotes on that mortgage, and man, I can't wait to go with the highest one. I mean, you don't really hear that. Now, there's a bunch of questions still on this. How can QE be deflationary? I don't understand. I thought QE was inflationary. All right. When I say the QE is deflationary until it's inflationary, what I mean is that monetary policy, and this was very hard for me. It took me a long time to really grasp this, and I understand if it's confusing, but the Fed doesn't just get what they want. So when the Fed tries to ease financial conditions by doing quantitative easing, they actually tighten them, because we know that lower interest rates are a sign of tightening financial conditions. We know that. We have enough history to prove that. And so on their way to creating inflation, the Fed has to tighten financial conditions, which is deflationary, until what happens? Until there's lending growth. And when people borrow money and new money is created, then you get inflation. So again, quantitative easing causes financial conditions to tighten, or is deflationary until financial conditions ease and it becomes inflationary. So how do we know when it's going to be inflationary? Well, again, that's why every Friday we look at the H.8 data, because it tells us. And boy, this week, there's no signs of inflation. If you're looking for it, you're not going to find it in the H.8. Now, the Consumer Price Index came out today, and the market had an odd reaction. I was talking to a big friend of the show, Chris Stark, this morning, and I was like, you know, I'm kind of surprised about the reaction. I totally expected Treasury yields to rise, because the CPI beat expectations of a 1.3% year-over-year increase, and I think instead of the 1.2, and interest rates went down. And I thought, well, that's kind of odd. I would have expected them to go up. But let's take a look and see, is this trend likely to continue? When we look at the money multiplier, against the consumer price index, you can see the money multipliers headed down, and we'll get to the slide deck here in a little bit, but that tells us that the trend of this consumer price index rising is likely coming to an end. And it doesn't mean that next month it won't rise or can't rise for the next 2 months. It's just that rate of growth is likely to slow and potentially start to roll over, because the money multiplier, when it rises, suggests there's inflation. When it's falling, it's very strong view of deflation or disinflation. Let's take a look at the consumer price index against the trade weighted dollar. This is what Chris and I were talking about this morning, was that the consumer price index has really gotten a boost from a weaker dollar. And with the dollar starting to flatten out and potentially bottom, as I believe it is bottoming, that will also suggest that the consumer price index is also peaking and likely to roll over if my view on the dollar is right. And it's simple. My view on the dollar, which gets challenged pretty much every day, and I love it, because most people think the dollar is headed lower. They're very dollar bearish, but I'm really dollar bullish. And the reason I'm dollar bullish is simple, because when interest rates go down, treasury bond prices go up, and there is a relationship even with the trade weighted dollar and treasury bonds. Because when treasury bonds rise or treasury yields fall, it's a sign of tight or tightening financial conditions. Well, if the dollar is weakening, even against other currencies, it means that financial conditions are easing. Well, only one can be right. Well, the whole stock market, you know, the pool of investors is really betting that the dollar is right. And yet the Fed and the large commercial banks, they're betting the bond market is right. Kind of guess who's going to be right in the end. I'll hook my cart to the side of the Fed and the large commercial banks. All right, let's take a look at, we're going to look at the normal data, the H.8 data, the charts. I also want to spend a little bit of time at the end looking at this week's 30-year treasury bond auction and kind of go through that with you, and then we'll hopefully have some time to hit a few charts on our way out. So let's take a look at the H.8, and this was a big surprise. I even made some notes. Treasury and agency securities went up by $46 billion. So last week, large commercial banks bought $19 billion of mortgage-backed securities and $27 billion of U.S. Treasury securities for a net gain of $46 billion, even after they made some adjustments to their other securities here. And, you know, when people say that nobody wants to buy bonds, well, you know, the banks are buying them and the Fed's buying them. And even though you're hearing China, you know, reduce its exposure a bit, other foreign central banks are still buying them. Not as rapid pace, because global trade is contracting or very weak. But nevertheless, there is a demand for bonds. Let's take a look at commercial and all loans and leases at commercial banks fell $28 billion. Commercial industrial lending fell by $18 billion. Real estate, ouch, down by $16 billion. The only really good part of this was consumer lending was effectively flat, down, you know, half a billion, with credit cards down $2 billion. But there was some increase in other consumer loans. So consumer lending's flat, tells you there's no demand from the consumer, and everything is contracting. And the simple answer to this is, it means there is, or what does it mean for interest rates? Does it mean that interest rates are too high, too low, or just right? It means they're too high because there's no lending demand. And yeah, I get that in a debt-based economy, there's always a demand to borrow money because there's a shortage of dollars. Well, it's still not transpiring, even because the banks don't want to lend. We looked at those financial conditions or lending conditions, which are tightening, and we're hearing from insiders at commercial banks, hey, there's just not much lending going on here. Let's take a look at the M2 money supply, which it actually rose by $78 billion, but really not a whole lot of activity there. The 12-month rate of change did increase slightly, and the six-month rate of change increased slightly, but the three-month rate of change is falling. It looks kind of like a topping pattern from a technical analysis standpoint going on in the M2. And I do expect the M2 to fall as people have to start repaying back on their loans and other things they put in deferment. that money is going to come have to come out of savings. So the biggest increases in the M2 this week was in savings and checking deposits. So we look, the monetary base, which is updated every 2 weeks, it increased last week, which helped push the money multiplier lower that we already looked at. It's down to 3.79. So since this is only updated every other week from the monetary base perspective, we'll be interesting to see if the money multiplier falls next week. And if it does, it'll have to be due to the M2 coming down, since the monetary base will be flat. How about real estate loan growth? Down to 3.26 from a year ago. This is super weak. I mean, this is not a good sign given all the activity in the mortgage market of people talking about, you know, buying homes and all the refinancing going on. This is weak. And the key here that most people don't understand is you have to have new loans and new money being created as old loans are being paid down. Because as someone, you know, every time you make a payment on a loan, the principal value of that payment is destroyed. And it, when you're at low or zero interest rates, money is destroyed really quick. So you have to have a lot of lending to offset it. What we're seeing is a failure in monetary policy. Central banks keep lowering interest rates, looking for inflation, and they get it for brief periods, but it's ultimately transitory because it leads to more deflation as all these loans are paid off. So it's very interesting to see this big drop in real estate loan growth. Look at the 3-month rate of change, is hovering back over zero. And you know, this thing normally doesn't go negative till after a recession, but you know, we're obviously in it now, and it looks like it's going to head negative in a recession. And that is, again, bearish for home prices. People ask them, why do you think home prices are going to come down? Because of the debt that supports the housing market is going to contract. How about commercial industrial loan growth? Down to 17.11 from a year ago. 6-month rate of change is just under 15. The 3-month rate of change is also down below 6.5%. This is falling, and with no sign of recovery coming. And with the other two falling together, loans and leases, and all commercial banks represent about a third of all debt. Growth rate is down to 6.12. 6-month rate of change is down to 2.76. 3-month rate of change is down to 2.35. All of them are falling, again suggesting interest rates are too high. How about consumer loans? Credit card loan credit card growth rate is flat at 9.5, or not flat, it's actually, I had all of them updated. I got one wrong. This is down to 9.57 from a year ago. This continues to head lower. This is not a sign of consumer recovery. So we do know that consumers have been spending money, but clearly they're not charging it on their credit cards. They're paying cash or using their debit cards. All right, let's quickly, I want to look at a chart of 30-year treasuries, because on that H.8, let me just kind of, you know, let's go back just so we're on the same page, is all of these purchases were the week ending September 2nd or September 4th. Rumor has it that that could be the Bond King's father's birth date. Could be. And anyway, so this week here, when yields went down, when we look at the 30-year, there you have week ending the 4th, which is this big move higher here. Well, the large commercial banks were buying, you know, a monster amount of $46 billion in U.S. Treasuries and mortgage-backed securities. I mean, that is quite a bit of bond buying. All right, let's take a look at the auction. Now, just so you know, from a bond perspective, you know, if you're bond bullish, again, you're the kid of school that gets made fun of all the time until you're right when everyone fails their test and you get the A+. Just so you know, every bond auction that's about to happen, it's going to be weak. That's the general market response. Oh no, you're going to, there's another treasury bond auction, it's going to be terrible. And yet they've been pretty good, even though the two earlier ones this week were kind of billed as, you know, poor demand, because there wasn't just massive flood of people demanding U.S. paper, mainly from foreign investors. Their demand was down a little bit. Well, trade is down too. But the 30-year was actually really strong. And what's interesting to me is you see primary dealers. Now, remember, they are required to bid at auctions, but there is a minimum. And they bid on a $23 billion auction over $30 billion. So clearly there's a demand from primary dealers for long-dated U.S. paper. And what's interesting to me is primary dealers got $4.9 billion. Now, the assumption here that I'm making is that The primary dealers, which I know some are owned by, some of them are owned by commercial banks, but just to kind of lay spread it out in my mind, the primary dealers flip their new issuance entirely to the large commercial banks, who then sell it to the Fed. Now people say, well, no, long rates, Steve, they got to go up. They got to go up. I said, well, here's the thing that you're missing is in between those the 30-year auctions, there's 30 days, right? There's a month. And in a block of 30 days, the Fed's buying $10.5 billion of 30-year bonds. How much did the primary dealers get? They got $5 billion. That means there's $5.5 billion of 30-year bonds that need to be bought or taken from primary dealer inventory to feed the Fed. So when people tell me, oh no, 30-year rates are going, it really? I mean, the primary dealers have to go out to the open market and source $5.5 billion of long-dated treasury bonds over the next 30 days just to maintain their current inventory, or they're going to watch their inventory go down. Now, they may let that happen, but month after month, the Fed is continuing at $10.5 billion. That is huge. Let's take a look at some other charts real quick. We've got the S&P 500 breaking its upward trend, threatening to head lower, but at the moment, finding support is 50-day moving average. Remember, rallies start when a security crosses its 50-day and reconfirms it. So this could be a reconfirmation with equity prices heading higher. We don't know. Liquidity conditions look pretty weak. NASDAQ's in the same boat. Dow's in the same boat. And the Russell 2000's in the same boat. It broke through its 50-day. But the other ones are okay. So we'll see if that happens. The VIX, it did get up over 31. And I said, hey, watch out. When this thing gets over 31, sellers wisely defended it because they know when it gets over 31, they risk things getting out of control, and they're driving the VIX back lower. But perhaps the next time it gets over 31, they won't have the ammunition to keep it lower. We'll see. 30-year treasury yields we looked at, they keep getting rejected up here. Why? Well, there's no lending demand. Plus, big banks are buying, Fed is buying. Still tells us the direction for treasury yields is headed lower. You break below this 1.2, the next time it comes knocking on this door, watch out, bottom comes out. Let's take a look at the energy sector real quick. Mainly led, the XLE, largest energy ETF is mostly ExxonMobil and Chevron stock, and it broke its topping pattern that I said that eventually would. It's breaking through here, suggesting the XLE is at least headed down into the high 20s. Perhaps even a retest of its all-time low would be very interesting. Financial stocks are breaking their upward trend line as well, which would make sense because financial stocks generally move in alongside treasury yields or inverse treasury bonds, depending on how you like it. And but it is testing its 50-day moving average, but my guess is this is headed much, much lower. Looking at the gold mining stock, still in a topping pattern because the dollar, well, it is in a bottoming pattern. And my guess is the dollar is going to be here for another month-ish before it moves higher. And if I'm right on that, it's because it's going to look like this bottoming pattern going all the way back to 2018. Spent about 3 months here and then took off from there. So we're, I think, about 2 months in here. Be interesting to see if it continues to play with its 50-day moving average, which is coming down, and then lets the 50-day start to bottom before it takes off. That'll be pretty interesting to see how that plays out. And of course, we've got emerging market stocks. They're breaking their upward trend line as well, threatening against their 50-day moving average. Maybe it finds support here and goes back up. Who knows? Be very interesting to watch how that plays out. And of course, we can't leave without looking at TLT, the long bond, the inverse of 30-year treasury yields. And I said, is, you know, there's a lot of support under here. It did find buyers. The bears and the bulls are scrimmaging here, you know, battling out. I don't know who has the ball. Maybe the bulls have it back. I don't know. I think we'll find out here pretty soon. But the long-term direction is the bulls have the ball, break the 172, and next time you've got the bull market and bonds headed higher. So with that, be sure to like. Yes, I did remember. For those of you who remember, I forget. And subscribe. I'm happy to have you. Look forward to reading the comments this weekend. And we'll be back on Monday to take a look at how hedge fund managers are positioned to see what's going on in the markets. I'm Steve Van Meter. Thanks for joining me today. And we will see you soon. Oh, you know what? Can't hit the show without putting the crown on. There we go. Bye now. The content of this video is provided as educational information. It's not done by investment or other advice. This material is not to be construed as a recommendation or solicitation to buy or sell a security financial product instrument or to participate in a particular trading strategy. This video was prepared by Stephen Van Meter. Personal capacity, opinions expressed in this video that do not reflect the view of Atlas Financial Advisors, Inc. or Stephen Van Meter Financial.